Hello everybody, I'm Don Counts and this is Tim Troutman. The evening of Wednesday, April 3rd, 1974 is a date that will live in the memories of Lincoln Countyans as an evening of stark terror.
At least two large F4 to F5 tornadoes of the 148 tornadoes that occurred in 13 states moved across the southeast part of Lincoln County in an hour, producing extensive and complete terrible destruction in their path, with six people being killed and over 100 injured. This documentary will detail what happened that fateful evening in Lincoln County, including eyewitness accounts from several residents who were directly affected by the tornadoes. The objective of this project is to not only historically document how the super tornado outbreak affected Lincoln County residents, but to remember those who were lost, discuss how warning technology has changed since 1974, and what we have learned from this horrible weather disaster.
So join us as we go back to the evening of April 3rd, 1974, and see how Lincoln County was changed forever by this evening of stark terror.
In Alabama, they slashed through Guin, Jasper, Lafayette, heading north toward Huntsville.
Here's the latest bulletin, Nell. A hook echo indicating tornado activity has now located over northern Lawrence County. The tornado is on the ground at Langtown, or 26 miles west of the city of Huntsville, taking everything along as it goes.
In Huntsville, Civil Defense Director Harris Mitchell already has the Emergency Operating Center on alert.
Give it to Philip and have him plot it on the map. Mr. Wiseman, let's
here we are.
Put the warning out again.
Persons in treated courts and mobile homes elsewhere are urged to evacuate and get to a place of safety.
Is anyone in there? You better take cover. There's a tornado coming.
A tornado is visible here at the airport. Projected path next few minutes will put it in the Harvest, Tony, Meridianville, Hazel Green areas of the county.
We got a spotted headed our way.
All day. It was unusual day. The wind blew.
Extremely windy. It was warm.
The skies were yellow color.
But I remember right before dark, you remember how pink it got? It absolutely was the pinkest outside that I've ever seen in my life. I mean, it would just radiate into the windows.
It was a hot, muggy day, and they was telling us there's gonna be some bad storms come in that afternoon.
Well, I remember going to church for 7 o'clock service, and the pastor had called it off. He met everyone at the parking lot and said that there's a tornado in Tanner, Alabama, and we needed to take cover and not be in church, be at home in a safe place.
We understand from other reports here at 17 minutes past 7 o'clock this evening that a tornado has been spotted up in the northern part of the county, too, in the Ardmore area and also toward East Limestone. Regardless where you are in Limestone County, Alabama, and Morgan County, Alabama, you take a place of shelter. I don't care if you live inside the city limits. I don't care where you live. You take a place of shelter immediately. If it's in the hallway of your home, open the windows to the north or to the east and take a place of shelter, because these things are touching down in every direction under the cloud. Well, that is hitting a little bit everywhere. So please take a place of shelter. We urge you to do that. It is a severe storm. Before it reached us, it already claimed 20 lives in other parts of the nation earlier this afternoon, and it is, of course, heading in our direction, and we're feeling the results of it.
We are in Van Town, Tennessee on April the 3rd, 1974. Approximately around 7:30 at night, a tornado come through and destroyed the Van Town Church of Jesus. At the time we were getting ready to dismiss church, Mr. Charles Holt had stepped out before church was over, and he come back in and said that the skies were yellow color, and that it was really quiet, and they told us everyone to take cover. Things happened so fast. My dad, Milton Moorhead, and the pastor, Baxter Hope, were trying to raise the windows. Mr. Hope was sucked out the window, and it did take his life. And within seconds, it sounded like a freight train had come through and the church was destroyed. It was a very scary thought at that time. Ms. Belle Holt, who passed away this last year at age 100, was my guardian angel. She did cover me during this, and after the tornado, as they pulled people out, I was put to the side of the church where the preacher had been sucked out the window. There were several other members injured the night. My sister was fortunate to get out and go for help up the road. My mom was hit with some tube of fours and was taken by ambulance to the hospital. My dad had a tube of four to go through his back and was unaware until we were at the hospital to check on mom. And there were several that had minor cuts and bruises, but other than the fatality, there were really no life-threatening injuries.
Well, it was on a Wednesday night, and the weather report was that the weather was going to get real bad, so I stayed at home. I didn't go to church, and the power went off. We was watching television, and the power went off, and I come out on the porch and standing right about where you're at, Don, and look to your left, and I could see the storm coming across the field here. I went in the house, and I remember closing the curtains to the picture window, and we went and laid down in the hall, and just about that time why it hit, and it didn't seem like it lasted 15 seconds, 30 seconds, and a terrible noise and a wind. And when I got up, I come out, and this house here was gone. The next house was gone, the next house, and then up at the church, it was tore up real bad. And our house was just completely gone except for the walls in the hall and the back wall, and that was where we was laying. And later we heard that three of our neighbors had been killed that night. We had a picture window right about here, and I closed the curtains to the picture window. I thought maybe a little glass might break or something and fly, and so I closed those curtains. The television had it out that night that there was storms all around, and I think they said that there was one somewhere around Harvest and coming towards maybe Hazel Green and coming this way. And like I said, I come out on the porch here and looked across the field, and we could see it coming. Just a big black cloud with lightning strikes going in and out.
First was two nights before that, there was tornado warnings out, and one of our daughters said, "What would we do if a tornado came here?" And I said, "Go lay down in the hall and cover your head." And so that night she knew what to do. And I just remember the walls jumping up and down and moving and a lot of racket, and I felt like a vacuum cleaner trying to suck you up.
I was here at home working out in front of the barn on the fence when we first got the weather alerts, and Danny, my brother, come over, he and his family, because I've got a basement right under this area here, and he was a little bit concerned about the weather too. And when the clouds come up, we could see back in the west, just, and it looked like we didn't think it was a tornado because it was so big. It was just a big, it looked like a funnel, but I never heard of or never seen a tornado that big. And we could see it moving up across, and then there was little spin-off tornadoes that
was coming off of it, and we had one that actually, one of the spinoffs that hit right here, and it took the roof off of my little barn out here and messed up some trees and stuff around in the yard. But we wound up going into the basement after this got pretty rough here. And we stayed in the basement for, I guess, about 15 or 20 minutes. And we come out, and of course, the weather was still really bad. And there was still a little spin-off tornadoes that was coming around. And we didn't venture out too far, but there was, I guess, about 30 minutes after the big one came through, we started getting out a little bit and went back to Danny's house. And we had a shed over there that we had stored. We had just purchased all of our chemicals for the farming operation, and we had those stored in a shed over there, and that shed was gone. And the chemicals were just sitting there. They didn't mess any of them up, except it busted a bag or two of it, I guess, where some of the debris hit it. But we immediately decided we better get something over there to get those chemicals out of the weather. So we went, got one of our trucks, and started loading up the chemicals and got them all in a shed down here at my daddy's place where they'd be out of the weather. And then we began to venture out and look around the other areas of the, and we started hearing about some of the deaths around. We had most of our farming operation was based off of a farm right across from where Maurice Caldwell had a trailer park. Not at that time, but there was a trailer park there. But we had a house and a dairy barn and a cattle barn, farm equipment there right across from where that trailer park was. And just on up the road, about half mile to three quarters of a mile, I had another farm up there that had two barns and a house, and we had some equipment stored up there also. And everything was just gone. The houses were just flattened. They was hardly, the debris was there, but you couldn't tell it was a house. And the barns were, all the roofs were gone, but the hay was still sitting in the barn loft, you know, just like it was, just like we had put it up there. And very little of it was even disturbed. In fact, we had a hen nest in one of the barns up in the hay, and the eggs were still in the nest. And we had about 120, 30 head of cattle on the two farms, and we didn't have a fence left anywhere to hold them. So, but we had 40 acres on the back side of the what we call the hail place, where our farming operation was based from. We had 40 acres up there that we had a fence around it, but we had already turned the ground, got it ready to plant. We were talking about starting to plant. But that's the only fence we had. So we brought the cattle down from the upper place and brought them down to that farm, and we put that 120 head of cattle on that 40 acres, and they didn't have any grass or anything. It was already worked up, ready to plant. We had some silage in a pit, and we had some hay that we fed until we could. It took us about a week to get a fence back up on that property so we could get them back out on the pasture. And of course, there was debris everywhere. Nails and planks. I mean, it was just scattered. There was one field in particular. We picked up 30 dump truck loads of debris and just piled it up in a pile. And of course, we burned it later, just trying to get it off the fields and get the nails and stuff out of the way. We hadn't That year we had numerous flats on our equipment, you know, because we didn't get it all, of course. We got all we could find, but we just had one flat right after another where we'd run over those nails. But that particular night, we had some cows that killed, had two befores stuck in them. Had one that looked like her just took the back of her head off. I don't know what hit her, but something hit her. And we had other livestock around that was there that some of it we didn't know where it come from, really. I mean, it looked like it just picked it up and dumped it in there. But we found later on when we was building fences and trying to get things going again, we found rabbits laying on the ground. It was skint. Just looked like right in the path of that thing where the tornado come through. I mean, there wasn't any fur left on them. They were just laying there skint, you know. And it honestly looked like they was places in trees where sage grass, where it took the sage grass off the field, and it was actually sticking into the tree, you know. And I mean, it's amazing. People don't believe that I wouldn't have believed it. I mean, in no way I could stick a piece of sage grass in a tree, but it actually was. There was just debris everywhere. We wound up that particular night, and after we got out and looked around a little while, and there was opportunity to come back home because they began to close down the roads and stuff to keep people out of the area, and because there was a lot of lookers, you know. Well, I got back here, and of course the weather was still bad. It was bad for 3 or 4 hours after the big storm come through. The lightning just flashed everywhere. Just continuously, just flash, flash, flash. But when I got back here, I couldn't even get in my own basement. It was full. People would come. There wasn't many storm shelters around at that time. But the next day, there was several started. People started putting them in. I mean, some of them didn't ever get finished, but there was a lot of storm shelters started in the next week or so after that big storm come through. But it had there was a big wide area of destruction from all the way across from Madison County, across Lincoln County, and I don't know how far north it went, but somebody said there's over 100 miles of where that particular storm stayed on the ground. I never did have the opportunity to get up in an airplane and look at it, but they said you could fly it, you know, and see the destruction. And it's just unbelievable, you know, what it did. But it was a terrible time for this particular area, trying to get things cleaned up and get somewhat back to a normal life. You know, it was really a bad time. If it actually hit your house and tore it up, you know, you probably had 6 to 8 months before you could get started back rebuilding. And I know there was some dairy farms around that they come in and people come in and helped do some makeshift buildings and use generators to power them with till they could get something back. And I believe that some cattle was even moved to other dairy farms where they could milk them, you know, for a while. But you're talking about 6 or 8, it took us a month or 6 weeks just to get the fields cleaned up where we could plant. We was prepared and ready to start planting when the storm hit. And all of our equipment, our silage and wagons and silage choppers and cotton pickers and cotton wagons and all those were destroyed. Our tractors, most of those were in different areas, so we still had equipment we could start and plant with and start working the ground back down quick as we got it up and shaped where we could. But the equipment we had stored was all demolished. There was nothing left. Now the spinoff when it hit here was within about 15 or 20 minutes of the big one when it went through. But they was tornadoes, little tornadoes that was, it kept us on a uneasy for a long time that night. In fact, it was probably 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning before I ever come back home and decided to settle down where we could rest just so we could get up the next morning and see what kind of damage it was. Because it was, we just didn't have any idea. Well, we thought we did when we went to bed that night, but we didn't have any idea how bad it was until we got up the next morning where we could actually see. We began to, Kathy was in the house and she was watching TV. I was out working, but she come out and told me that the weather was really looking bad and they'd had some reports of some storms in Alabama that was moving this way. And I come on in and she had me a sandwich fixed and I ate that sandwich and that's when Danny came over. They knew we had a basement we could get in, so that's when they came over and then he wouldn't hear. I bet he wouldn't hear 5 minutes or so until we started seeing the cloud in the back in the west, the southwest, and then started moving up. And like I said, we talked about him. Me and him talked about, was that a tornado? You know, it was so big. You know, I thought it was just a big thunderstorm coming through. You know, but of course we realized pretty quick it wasn't. You know, we knew there was more than a thunderstorm, and the closer it got, but the debris began to fall, and that's when we went into the basement. We just didn't know what was fixing to happen. And there was a couple of times I thought, well, this house was going to be blown away too. Constant. I mean, just one flash right after the other, just all for, I'm talking about for 4 or 5 or 6 hours. I mean, it was just one flash right after another. And I've never seen.
It even went this way. So
yeah, it just danced across the sky. Yeah, it wasn't as much cloud-to-ground lighting as it was straight across. I don't know what it was doing, but it was just one big flash right after another, and it went on for several hours. It rained, not hard, most of the time it wasn't hard, but just a straight line wind with rain in it that would really come down for a few minutes and then just slack off. It was still windy, you know, and still lightning and still thundering. And it was a night like I've never seen before and hadn't seen since, really. I've seen some bad weather since, but not like that was.
Well, all day it was unusual day. The wind blew, and I don't know. Of course, my dad was born in Oklahoma, and he was raised up till he was up maybe 12, and he knew about tornadoes, and he was scared. But anyhow, that night, we was watching Channel 31.
We were sitting there around watching the TV, and it was Ken Rainey, because he was my absolute hero after that. And of course, the weather radar back then was basically a black screen with circles on it and just white blobs. And how they read anything off that radar, I'll never know how they done it. But I was glued to the TV and we were watching the radar. And of course, the first tornado came through, we lost power.
And I guess it was about 8 o'clock, it went off.
When Daddy would ask you to do something, you know, you did it. You didn't say why, or you just did it. Well, I remember Daddy would, you know, he would go back and forth the door. You know, he talked to Papa, talked to Mama. You know, the power went off. Daddy was out in the car trying to get weather on the car radio. he came back in and he wanted, I know he asked me, I'm not sure if he asked Phyllis to help him try to get some of the windows open in the house. So we went around and the trim on the house had been painted not too much earlier. And yeah, some of the windows were stuck, couldn't get that open. Well, you know, a little bit later, Daddy said, everybody needs to get some shoes on. Well, you know, it's why, Daddy? Well, because I told you to. So I think, you know, Mom and Daddy sort of had an inkling that something was going to happen. So we got shoes on. Daddy told us to get a coat on, you know, put something on. And then, you know, it got to the point that, and of course, when you ask Daddy or Mama, is something going to happen? It's going to be okay. You know, nothing's going to happen. It's going to be okay. And I guess for me, it's a good thing Daddy did that. And Mama, because we would have been terrified, I guess, if we knew.
But the first tornado came, it wasn't very big, but it hit the tenant house over there where Milk Can lived, and there was his wife and her mother and her sister and all their children. And they got in their vehicle, and Maurice called up to Milk Barn and told Walter to run the cows out of the barn and to come, you know, leave the barn. Well, they met in front of the house, and they all got out and come in the house.
And I remember Daddy and Papa talking about, well, we have these big pet silos that we fed out of, and I remember them discussing, well, we can go over to the silos. We can pull the vehicles down in the silos. Ah, there's no need, you know, it'll go around us. It always goes around us. I remember that. So me and Paul were playing, and you know, we weren't, like I said, at that age you don't know to be afraid unless your parents are afraid. That's how you gauge your amount of fear. So we were just playing, and we were out on the front porch playing. I remember there was a lot of water because it had been raining real hard, and we were scooting our feet through the water out on the front porch, and Papa and Daddy was there, and they told us to come in, and I think they had seen what was going to happen. So we came in, and Daddy told me to go get my motorcycle helmet. I had just got a little mini bike, and he told me to put the helmet on. And he was an avid race fan, and there he had a white racing helmet. It was a souvenir type thing. It had two checkered flags on the front and a little bee on. I'll never forget. And he made Paul put that on. And I remember Daddy, he was so calm. No excitement. I remember him saying, y'all need to blow the candles out because the lights were out. And I remember Mother had gone out to her car to Wixie, tried to pick up a Wixie radio station, the AM station in Federal, had come back on the air because it was so bad.
The door from Mama's kitchen to her utility room was a regular wood door, but it had a spring on it where, you know, when you opened it, it would close itself back. And Daddy had taken a kitchen chair and propped that door open, trying, I guess, to get air into the house. Right before that really deep roar, I heard that door slam, like it was sucked shut.
Of course, when the others come, she got pushed back in the hall. And the last thing I remember her saying was, Mother, I wished I could hold your hand.
About the last words I heard were, everybody grab a hold of somebody. And I love you. I love you, kids.
And I heard the silverware on the table. I mean, it was flying everywhere. And it seemed like it was over, just like that.
And then all you could hear was just it sounds like thunder when it's rumbling just really, really deep. Just so loud you really couldn't hardly bear it.
Like what Donald was talking about, just unbearable. And then all of a sudden it got quiet right before it hit. It's just like you just flip a switch. Mm-hmm. Nothing. Total silence. And then I remember the corner of the roof, the sheetrock falling in the corner of the roof raising up on the house. And the silverware. I remember the silverware. And it sounded like the drawers were pulling out of the cabinets and the silverware was just hitting the floor. And then it was just a boom.
And then just felt stuff hitting you. I guess it was the dirt, the rocks, the, you know, just felt little stings all over you. And didn't really seem like it lasted a long time. But once it passed, you could feel it raining on you. I mean, there was nothing there, you know, kind of disoriented.
And when nobody moved, I mean, it just seemed like we sat there for 5 minutes. And Maurice said, somebody move. Well, we were just there when nobody moved. And finally he got the calling names and everybody got the answer except Paul, he was the youngest. And somehow, some way, he got down under my mother. She was hovering over him.
And then I remember Daddy calling out everybody's name, you know. And I was kind of towards the back end of the hallway, and some stuff had kind of fallen down in front of me. We all got out.
Then we all got up, and I remember the count. I remember everybody hollering, yeah, we're here, we're here, we're here. And I remember Papa turning around and blood being all over his face. And my Granny Langford had debris in her back, just looked like you just shot her with a shotgun. And we got herself, and I remember the power line, that big power line, and it was as tight, you could have played a tune on it, but it come right through the center of the house. And we started walking toward Vantown, and we heard something, and it turned out to be the propane tank. It had blew the propane tank from my granny and them's house down the road out in the field, and it was spewing. And we all ran, and we was taking cover again because we thought there was another tornado. And I remember when we got out of the debris, looking back toward the mountain, and there was two more tornadoes back between us and the mountain, going one right behind the other one. And they were smaller than the one that hit us. My mama said the one that hit us was a solid wall.
And I let me say, Mama, when we got out, you know, we wanted to see, as kids, we wanted to see what just happened. And Mama told us kids, she said, I don't want you to look. And of course, you know, when you're told not to look, you're going to turn around and look. And when it would lighten, you could see that thing going, you know, back this way. I mean, you could see that, you could just see that shape. But Mama told us not to look. You know, we had to look.
But when we got out and we looked back toward the southwest, you could see stars. It was just as clear as a bell. The stars were out. But like LaDonna said, when you turn around and look right behind you, you could see that thing going back toward the northeast. And
I had an old antique sewing rocker that was in the living room, and it was on top of all that debris. And I could see it. And we had a porch that, I guess 2 feet up off of them. And when you stepped off, there was just mud and rock. And of course, it was all in your hair and glass. And I really didn't know it till I went to go to bed the next morning about 2:00.
I remember when we got out and it was lightning, and it was constant lightning. There was no pauses. It was just one right after another. But you could look toward the southwest, toward Vantown, and it looked like the desert. There was no trees, no houses, no power lines, nothing. I mean, just as far as you could see, it just was flat. There was no landmarks. You know, it's the weirdest thing to see, nothing. Of course, then we came back up to the house, and that's when the Edwards man picked us up and took us to the storm house in Flintville. I remember that, and it was packed. There were so many people in there. And of course, new people would come in, and it's like, well, there's another tornado here, or they seen another, and there were so many tornadoes, it was like you didn't go outside, you're just going to get hit by one. And then David came and picked us up, and we started toward grandmother's, which was on Wellesley Road. And every direction we went, I'll never forget, every time we'd go here, go there, this way, that way, there was trees, there was houses, debris, everything. It was in the road, so we ended up going from over to Elora and coming in the back way, which the thing had crossed 64, going up toward Shady Grove, but we were able to get through there and get over to Elora. Of course, you know, we got there and we were all in shock. We didn't know the extent of what had happened, being children. The next morning we woke up and I thought it was all a bad dream, but I didn't know why I was at grandmother's.
My daddy was never really emotional, you know. He usually consoled everybody else. You know, you didn't console him. And me and my sister were in my grandmother's and granddaddy's bed. I'll never forget. And their house, their windows were, They were old, and to open them up, you had to prop them up with a, you know, prop them up with a stick, and they just had springs on them. And I can remember hearing Daddy break down to Mama, say, "We've lost everything. We have nothing left." And as an 11-year-old, and my mother now was consoling my daddy. I'll never forget that. But I could hear, because it was at the back door, and I guess they had just stopped before coming into the house of my daddy. I never heard my daddy cry. And then I know the next day, it was a little bit on up in the day before we got to come, but I can remember stuff up in the trees, wigs, and all kinds of stuff. You just wonder how it got up there, you know. And cars turned over. I mean, it just, it was an incredible sight to see what we walked out of. Of course, at that time, being that age, you don't really know, I guess, how blessed you are. But, wow, it was by the grace of the good Lord that we survived. That's the only reason.
But we went over, and I remember D-Laps had sent some trucks over there, M&M D-Laps. They had a box truck, and they were over there, and, I mean, everything was gone. I remember seeing cows land with 2x4s run through them. I remember being up in the trees. The dairy barn was gone. And, you know, I just remember walking through what was left of the house.
That night, the tornado came from the southwest, be that direction up there. Our house was built right here where this shop is now, kind of out to the front. The tornado came from that direction, which is toward Vantown. And it came across and blew those houses up. There were houses up that direction, blew them away. This house right over here in the distance was there that night, didn't even blow a window out of that house. It moved across, came through here, blew this house away, our house, and then traveled on back into the northeast, back this way. Now, that our house was built here. We built our shop up on the old carport concrete. This part here was added later, but back here in this part of the shop is the original pad of the carport. That was, we had a camper and a boat, and two vehicles were sitting under here. And this floor, this concrete here, was the original concrete from that night that our carport was on. All these gouges and stuff that you see in this concrete were actually made that night of the tornado. They were metal posts that was holding the top of it up. It ripped those out of the concrete. Now the dairy barn that we had is about a quarter of a mile to the north of us. We have a calf barn. The old calf barn is built on the original slab that our old dairy barn was built on. Of course, we milk cows, so we had to get a barn up pretty quick after the tornado and start milking again. But we had started building a new dairy barn, and it completely destroyed it, and it was a good quarter of a mile from here. So that kind of gives you a little perspective on how wide the base of this tornado was.
The super tornado outbreak has been researched extensively to determine how this rare tornado outbreak can occur and what can be done to better prepare for an event of this magnitude in the future. In 1974, the nearest radars were a WSR-57 radar in Nashville that had World War II technology, in which the radar could only detect the intensity of the raindrops within a storm. Doppler radar did not exist yet, and certainly not dual polarization Doppler radar, which can not only be used to accurately determine the type of precipitation that's falling within a storm, including hailstone size and hailstones, but also the Doppler effect, which allows meteorologists the ability to analyze the thunderstorm winds that are blowing inbound and away from the radar. The Doppler effect allows meteorologists the capability of seeing wind circulations in real time, which undoubtedly aid the detection of the developing tornadoes. The average tornado warning lead time, or the heads up that we provide the residents that the National Weather Service gave residents in 1974, was out on an average only of around 2 minutes, and that's compared to the nearly 14-minute average warning lead time in 2014. The Skywarn program was born from the April 3rd, 1974 tornado outbreak. The National Weather Service has further developed an aggressive outreach program since 1974, with thousands of Skywarn storm spotters being annually trained across the U.S. and including in Lincoln County. Skywarn storm spotters are the eyes and ears of the National Weather Service, and they provide real-time reports of severe weather directly to the National Weather Service to assist in the severe weather warning process. Weather satellites and observing equipment also are used by the National Weather Service to detect the development of severe weather, and that has improved dramatically since 1974.
So I came up to my mom and dad's, and they had a basement in a rock veneer house, and we felt like that would be a safe place if something happened. And we were up there visiting with them, and when we got a call from our tenant that lived on the dairy a couple of miles down the road where I also lived, and said that the tornado or some kind of storm had hit down there, and they didn't have a vehicle, and they were ready to leave home because the house was damaged. So we went down to get them. I did. I was the first one to leave my dad's, and I got there just in time for the second tornado, about 20 minutes after the first one. So, sort of strange how it happened. When you pull into the yard down there, of course there was no power. So I shined my car lights toward the house, which was east. The second tornado was coming out of the west to my back, and I never saw it. I just heard a train-like sound and a lot of wind, and the man that lived there, Mr. Bob Simmons, came to the door and went back in the house, and I couldn't understand why. But he was looking west, and he saw the tornado. It was to my back. So then it got there, and my car began to rock, and I realized something was happening. So there was an old storm house right across the little road there, and even though I was dressed for church and had on slippers, that ankle-deep water wasn't a real problem for me. I went right on in there. And I guess I was in there about 5 minutes, and my dad got there because we didn't leave at the same time from his house. So when he got there and shined the lights, his lights in there on me, I decided it's time to come out of the storm house. And by now, Mr. Simmons was ready to go somewhere. He'd been through two tornadoes in about 20 minutes. So he came on out and climbed through the brush out into the yard and got in the car and came on up to my dad's and broke the passenger window out of my car. So he had to be careful about glass in the back seat, and his wife got in the front seat with me. We still didn't have any idea how much damage was done. So when we got them safe and quieted down, we loaded up and went back down there. And of course, it was calm. There's still a lot of lightning, but the tornadoes were gone, and we were able to really assess what had happened. Not as much as we did at daylight, but we could tell. When it was lightning in the west, I looked that direction, and the silo was gone. And I told my dad, I said, I believe the silo's gone. He said, nah, never heard of one blowing away. In a minute, it lightning right big, and he looked, and he said, I believe you're right. It's gone. I think it's a 60-foot silo, and I think it was 6 or 8 feet left. The first one probably did more damage to the dairy itself than the second one did. It was a little north of there. There was a house, the last house before you get to the dairy. When I went by, going down there, I met the man that lived in that house, Bobby Simmons. And when I got to his house, the top was gone, and I thought, well, I guess I'd leave too. When I picked his dad up and came back, the house was gone. Second one got the rest of it. So it was a little further north, I guess, the main part of it than the first one. This is the old milk barn that we were using at the time, and top was taken off of it, and you can see guys up on there putting the top back. We didn't get to milk the cows that day till about lunch. We didn't have a generator, and there was one borrowed and used in the community, and we had to wait our turn, and so we didn't milk but one time that day. And we got started about lunch. And this is a shot from the road out behind this barn. There was a silo and a feeding trough and an old barn with a loft in it, and of course all of that was gone after the tornadoes. This is the tenant house that Mr. Simmons was in when I went down there to get him after they called and said that they had had a storm and took most of the top off. We couldn't get building supplies the next day. We couldn't find any 5V10, hardly at all. So we took the top off of the old house there and put on the milk barn, and then we were able to find enough roofing to cover the house before dark that day. And I had a lot of good neighbors that came and helped that day. I don't know what we'd have done without them. This is the house that I lived in, down below the dairy. And we weren't at home, of course, but I'm glad. Did a number on it pretty much. You can see the cows in this picture. They were wanting to know why we hadn't been milked yet, and it was like way up in the morning. And we always started at 5 o'clock, and it's probably 10 there, and they didn't know what was going on yet. Yeah. We lost 8 cows and a few calves. The calves were in a stable, and the wall actually fell on them and mashed them. Wasn't that many, 3 or 4. But the cows were injured. 3 cows were under one tree down in the woods. We had to get log off of them before we could drag them out. Well, the fences were just torn down, as well as the power lines, and we just had to clean off. We had a bulldozer to come that day and clean up around the edge of the field and just put up an electric fence, temporary, because there wasn't any fences that you could really count on. They were in terrible shape. This is a picture of the feeding area where the cows went to eat silage after they were milked, and of course you can see there wasn't a very good place for them to eat after that morning. That night we had to improvise. That's another picture of the cows gathered up to the barn waiting to be milked, and men on top of the barn working on the roof. And again, the cows weren't milked till about lunch that day, and we had to pass a generator on down the road to some other people, so they weren't milked but once. This little cow here was dead when I found her the next morning, and she had a lath off of a building stuck in her back about 18 inches. I don't think she ever knew what hit her. It's a lath, which is a 1x4 that you nail 10 to.
Oh, okay. Wow.
And it apparently fell out of the sky.
Wow. Hmm.
And she's just out in the pasture, and it just happened to hit just right.
Wow.
And no telling how high it was, and it just like a sword coming out of the sky, you know. I had never seen anything like this, especially in person. And I never was scared of a tornado. I'd heard them talk about them, but I didn't have much respect for them. I wouldn't give you 15 cents for a storm house. I built a nice one after this, and I have much respect for them now.
As the day went on, it got stormier, and Harvey was in construction, so he was usually late coming home, and our son was 2 at the time. And I know that evening they started putting the watches out and the warnings, and I kept waiting for Harvey to come home. And so he finally got home, and I think it was dark, and it was starting to storm really bad, and we made the decision that we'd stay at the house because we were afraid that we would get caught out in it. And we got pillows and quilts and got in the bathroom like they told you to. And we kept watching the news, and I can't remember the weatherman's name. Do you remember?
Yeah, H.D. Bagley.
H.D. Bagley. And he was telling people what to do. At that time, it's to raise your windows, you know, 2 or 3 inches. And Harvey done all that. We got Matthew, that was our son, in the bathroom, and we put pillows and quilts, and the power went off, and I think that was about the first time, the first tornado went over, because it went over the top of us, and like you could hear the wind. And we were in the bathroom at the time, but that was the one that kind of went up and down and up and down. And we stayed in the bathroom, and Harvey would get up and go and look outside and listen. And I just remember him coming back before the big one hit, and he just said, "This is it. It's coming." And I'm sorry. And I just remember him saying, "I can hear it coming." And it's what they say, the sound. It is like a train coming. And we got down and got Matthew under the pillows and quilts. And just remember the house started shaking. And I just remember asking God to put his hand over us. And it just, that awful sound, and the timber started popping, and all of a sudden we just got hit with wind and debris, and he kept sliding away from me, and I was trying to hang on to him, and him to me, and I know it was just a few seconds and it was gone, but it just seemed like, you know, a lifetime, and we were getting hit with everything, and we felt it give. The house went up and started turning. We had some big oak trees in the front yard. And the house got, or what was left of it, got caught in the roots of it. And then it was gone. And we tried to get out of the house. And Matthew didn't have any scratches on him until we were trying to get out with him. And we fell, or I fell, and then Harvey got him. And just remember,
well, there's so much stuff around, debris around, that it was hard to walk. You know, you could, well, it was dark too, but you know, you go a few steps and you run across something, and you down and up and down, and it's pretty rough.
There was a silage wagon,
yeah,
that landed beside our house. And I wanted to climb under the silage wagon because I just wanted to hide. I thought it was coming back. And we found or Harvey saw, was it a flashlight that it got turned on out? We saw a light of some sort. I think it was a flashlight.
The thing that I remember is when we were going, you know, the road went right in front of the house, and the driveway up, and then Mr. John Armstrong lived next door. And instead of going, we were going to Mr. Armstrong's, and instead of going that way, we actually went backwards out the back of the house and down across the field, and that's where the silage wagon was. And we got down there, and I told Judy, I said, "We're going the wrong way." So we turned around, went back up, and then back down toward Mr. Armstrong's, and somehow or another his house was, I mean, just a few hundred feet away, and it was, I think he said he had some cracked brick maybe, yeah, somewhere, but other than that, everything down there was completely intact. And that's just, it's just a few hundred feet, you know, it's strange the things that they can do. And I don't know, I guess the time that it takes for them to go from point A to point B is what just blows your mind, you know. And because I remember looking out the back door, like Judy said, you know, and you could see it. I mean, it was coming right toward the house. And you know it's too late to go. So, you know, I told her, I said, well, it's coming straight at us. And anyway, the next thing, you know, I don't know. I guess it was seconds. But the next thing I remember is the pressure. I mean, it just...
Yeah.
I mean, it is terrible. And then everything just came apart, and it was gone. When we got outside, you know, we could see it. I guess it was at Maurice Caldwell's at that time, somewhere in that vicinity, and when it hit his house. So, but it's...
And it was huge. I mean, it's a, when you see them in the movies or something like that, they're just little cycle or... So, you know, a little up and down, and this was just, it was huge. Just, I'd never seen anything like that, and.
Don't ever want to see another one.
Harvey
no,
was,
I just had some cuts.
He was cut on his arm. They took stitches, because who knows what he was hit with, and when we went back, I don't think it was the next day, maybe 2 days later, it looked possibly like the chimney had fallen beside us and the bricks had landed on my back, and that's what they kept me for, just to make sure. It was more observation. It was bruised. And like I said, Matthew had a few scratches, but he wasn't. That was mostly when I fell with him.
God's hand, you know, I mean, you can't put it a different way. That's it.
And the house that was above us, the Warrens, did they live there then? Yeah. Only thing left there was the foundation. It brought their refrigerator, stove. I don't remember all.
It collided with...
With us.
Everything with right stove. There where we lived. It was just a pile. I don't know where they were.
No, they weren't at home. And
at that time.
It just seemed like on that road, or if there was someone there in that house, there was something left of it. But if no one was there, it was just like it just took the whole house. It was just amazing. Well, shortly after that, if there was the slightest hint of any kind of stormy weather, Harvey got us. We went to the storm pit that was beside my sister. That's where we would have went that day, but we were afraid we would get caught in it. And you still have the... You just think it's not going to happen to you, you know. It's going to go around you. And I'd never been involved in anything. I mean, been around... I was raised up north, so just was not a lot of tornadoes or anything like that, or that I remember. But afterwards...
There wasn't that many here at that time, I don't think, either. I mean, I never seen one.
He got us to the storm pit, and...
It gets to be a habit.
Yeah.
Just tell you the truth, you know, I don't know if it's fear or what it is, you know, you just want to go.
Be
sad. Still do.
We have one right behind the house.
There's one right there
now.
Behind the house, yeah.
So we go there now if it gets bad.
My house here, we have a small farm on, and we're actually located, if most people know where Flintville School's at, we're exactly 1 mile east of Flintville School. And that's where our house is located here. And we had the radio and TV on, and it was telling us about a lot of storms moving in here out of Mississippi and Alabama, coming on up this way, and for us to take care and take, if you lived in a trailer or anything, to get out. If you had storm cellars or whatever, to get in or get into your basement of your homes. When I got home, I had my wife and I and two small children, and had two vehicles here at the house, and we, I guess it was around 5:30 and 6 o'clock, we went to my uncle's storm cellar, Dub Nugent, here in Flintville, and he's got his storm cellar is probably an 8x10, 8x12, something like that, and people started coming in, and we were like sardines in a can. It was about 25 of us or so in that storm cellar. And of course, we were talking and carrying on, and it was hot and sweaty, and I had the little boy in my arms, and Kevin was the youngest, and he was not hardly a year old, and he was squirming and carrying, of course, it was hot and muggy. And anyway, a little while longer, about 45 minutes or an hour longer, Mr. Hudson came down, Teddy Hudson, and told us that we need to go home, that he saw the tornado come through. Of course, it missed his farm, and we were east of him. And of course, I got in my car by myself, made her stay there at the storm cellar. And I drove my car up here to about a quarter of a mile up the road. And I couldn't go any farther. The power lines was across the highway, or the blacktop out here. And, you know, you do some crazy things. You don't think about things like I pulled up there and lines and power lines and everything was all over the road. And like a big dummy, without thinking, I got out of the car and stepped across. I had a flashlight in my hand and stepped across all the wires and everything. Luckily, they were dead, but, you know, I could have been just as well, would have been alive, and I could have got electrocuted. But anyway, I had to walk on down this way because we couldn't get here any farther. And I got about almost to the halfway down between here and the Hoffmans up here. Their house was completely gone. I mean, there was nothing there but a bare spot. And I got down below here, and I heard a hissing noise out in the I guess it was about 100 feet or so from the road. I heard this hissing sound, and I shined my flashlight over there, and I could see a gas tank, and that hissing was this gas coming out of the gas tank. And I thought, well, that's my gas tank. My house and everything's gone. Didn't know it at the time, but it was my neighbor's tank up there that had been blown over my pasture. And I walked up to the house, and of course, the lightning was just flashing, just constantly on and off, on and off. And I could see a silhouette of the house, and I could see, well, the house was still here. And I walked up out here in front, walked up the driveway, and walked up on the porch. And what I did, I didn't even open up the front door. This picture window right here was completely gone. It was sucked out. And I just stepped over inside out of the porch and walked through the house. And everything was intact pretty much. There was one or two things that was sitting in front of the house, in front of the window, that was gone. And in the hallway in here, we got a hallway staircase, and it was blown down. And all of our Christmas articles upstairs, all the bulbs and everything was, you can imagine, they were blown down in the house. And I was walking all over glass everywhere. And didn't know it at the time. I found out later that it sucked out of the end of our house. It sucked out the house itself on the gable end was gone. And it actually sucked all the insulation out of the house. It was just like no insulation was in it. You mean there was none left? It was sucked it all out. The back side of the house, of course, the storm come out of the southwest, come through Van Town over there and up this way. And the back side of my house, right down, there was no shingles on it, even right down to the deck. It was just decking. It took all the shingles, the tar paper and everything off the house. And of course, a lot of things are going through your mind. And after the next day, we got out there and looked. And behind my house, I had two huge trees that I had previously topped that fall. So they were like two big stumps, if you would. And what happened is the tornado came through and completely tore my barn all to pieces, just sucked it up, and it was gone. I had a barn with a loft in it. And it was gone. I had a garage beside the house out here. It was gone. And what I think happened is the tornado come through and it hit those two big trees. They were like stumps. They were just, you know, had been topped. And they had bounced off those trees, come down and took that side of the house, took the shingles off. Didn't even touch the shingles on this side of the house. And it let back down. And out there where my tree out there is, that maple tree there, I had a big oak tree, and it laid it across the road and took my other car and pushed it out of there in the ditch with it and smashed the whole side out of it. That's kind of it in a nutshell. Of course, this was in April. My house, there was so much mud that came from the southwest. The mud covered the house. It looked like it was made out of dirty stucco. It was, you couldn't even tell what color, what the house was made out of. And the neighbors in behind us back there, Mr. and Ms. Turner, they had four children, stair steps. And they live on a dead end road behind us back here. This is where I live out here. Backside of my place is where you always heard where the light used to be at the tracks. And that's where they lived out back there, Mr. and Ms. Turner. And he told me later, he'd tell me his story of what happened about the first, there was one big tornado come through. And they were at home, of course, we were at Flintville. The tornado came through, took the top off. He had a new brick home back there, took the top completely off of it. And then he got his kids and his wife and kids in the car and wanted to leave out. Well, they couldn't because the power lines were across their dead-end road. And by that time, he looked up back toward the southwest, and among the flashes of light, there were two sister tornadoes. I call them sister tornadoes, what I call them. There was one right beside the other one. And they were just hopping here and there, here and there. Well, he said the only thing he knew to do was go back in the house, which didn't have a top on it. They got back in the house, he and his wife and four little kids, and took a baby bed mattress and put over them. And when those two tornadoes come through, the only thing was left, literally that was left, was their bathroom wall. They're in the bathtub. He and his wife and four kids, and all they got was a few scratches. It took his, he had a big old tree beside his house. It took his pickup tree, or pickup truck, took his pickup truck and the fork of the tree and set his truck right in that tree. We had a little dog here at the time. She was a little hound dog. And we found her 2 or 3 days later, 300 or 400 yards across over here in this field. There was no houses over there then. And of course, she was dead. And a lot of strange things happened. We had a lot of neighbors and people that came over a few days after helping us, trying to clean up the aftermath, you know. And you go out there and you see a 2x4, a 2x6, sticking up out of the ground, you think you would reach down and go to pick it up, and you couldn't. It was driven in the ground, some of them as much as 3 or 4 or 5 feet deep. We had to take a tractor and actually pull them out of the ground. And big old lumps of fescue and stuff. They actually pulled the grass out of the ground and set it back down. Now, there's one story I've told, and a lot of people don't believe this, but my neighbor up here, his house was completely gone. And the next day, I was up there and we was kind of looking around, and of course his house was gone, and his well house was gone as well. He had a hand-dug well. It's probably a 4 foot square hand-dug well. And we heard something running like water, and we couldn't figure out what it was. We walked over where this well was at, and I had my flashlight and I shined it down in the well. Well was probably 30, 40 feet deep. It wasn't all that deep. And we could see the water. What was making the noise was the water running out of the side of the walls in the well going down in the bottom was splashing. And actually what had happened is when that tornado come through, it sucked all the water out of the well. There was nothing, no water left hardly in it at all. That's hard to believe that kind of force was. My neighbor right up here above me here, a little house up here, it took the top off of that house. The only thing I think that saved my house really was those two big trees in behind my house. It hit them, kind of ricocheted up enough to where it just set back down over the house here. And a lot of things that, I'll tell you one, this one little story and I'll be quiet. She wants to tell something. My neighbor over here that lost his house, he had some paneling come out of his house. It blew it all the way over here, and on my black side of my house, there's up there in the I had weather stripping on the house, and the gable end of the house, and it took his piece of paneling, running in behind that weather stripping, sheared the nails off behind it, and it looked like you just put that piece of paneling over and nailed the weather stripping over it. I just couldn't believe something like that could happen. It was just hard to believe.
It just looked like a ghost town here. You know, it was so scary when morning came, you know, we couldn't sleep here because we didn't, there's no, everything was glass on it, you know. When that was sucked out the window, then it just blew dirt and everything in it, you know. And then there was, we went back through the house and there was like big old planks stabbed in the doors, you know, in the hallway and in the bedrooms, you know. And the windows was out at the back, and but it just looked scary, you know. Time we come in, I was scared to come in because I didn't know what I was facing. But I knew a lot of things was missing that had, you know, blew out the windows, you know. But just knowing that, you know, we weren't here, that was the main thing. I didn't care just long as we were safe, you know, and our two kids. So it was just scary, you know, really scary.
Well, I can say this, used to, even today, you could probably come up here and beat on my door at night and I may or might and may not hear you. But you can let it thunder way back in the west, really faint. And as an alarm clock goes off in my head, I'm ready to get up. And you don't get over that.
No, he used to be not scared of storms. He'd say, oh, it's okay, don't worry about it, you know. And I said, well, one of these days we're going to get it because we're in a path. We've always been in this pathway. So I've been threatening every 3 years. 3 years go by, and I said, we need a storm shelter. And he said, we'll get one. So we got one last year. And I said, look what we went through, and we didn't have a shelter to go to. And I said, well, what are we going to do? You know, I always say, what are we going to do if a storm comes? And it says it's hitting at Fayetteville. He says, we're going to get in that little closet in there and we're going to just huddle down. Or we might get behind that recliner. And I said, we both won't fit in behind there. So it.
But we do have a nice storm shelter now. It's nice to have it. Hope we never have to use it. And this is our house right here. We're exactly 1 mile east of Fayetteville School. And the tornado come from this direction right back in here, which is the southwest. And it came through this way. If you show it around this way right here, you'll see the maple tree. This maple tree I planted in 1974 after the tornado. There was a big, huge oak tree that was there, a water oak tree that was about 4 or 5 foot in diameter. It laid it across the road. So if we can go around this way, and I'll show you which way the tornado come from in that way, and I'll show you where our storm shelter's at. Okay, this is the upper side of the house. Our land's kind of low. We had to fix a place here that we could put a storm shelter, and we got this one right here. It's made in Lewisburg, Tennessee. It's made in two halves, and the whole thing weighs a little over 19,000 pounds. It has a big, huge door on it, and we open it up, and it's designed very good. You have water that will not get in it. The air, it flows through and it does not condensate or anything. It's approved by the EPA. It's a 10 gauge door. Still, I feel pretty safe in it. But anyway, this is the tornado came back from this direction over here. As you can see about where the pond's at, came through this direction right here and straight on through. If you looked at a map and of this area and you could put a straight line down, you could see how straight the tornado went, actually just as straight as it could be. And a lot of tornadoes they'll pop around here and there, but this in here is just like a snake. It would just go over the hills, through the valleys, and it did not miss anything. It took everything in its path that it hit.
Our house was located on Highway 121 North, used to be known as Shady Grove Road. At that time, it was one of, if not the last house in Lincoln County. Franklin County line was just past where we lived. And our church that we attended, where we were at that evening, was just about a half a mile from the house. That night, I was a youngster. I was about around 8 years old. But it's probably one of the most memorable and likely one of the most traumatic events, definitely from my childhood and maybe for all of my life. It was a Wednesday night. We typically went to church at a little country church about maybe a half a mile down the road from where we lived. And I can remember my mom and dad sitting around the table. They had just watched the news, and there was some forecast of some really bad weather that was going to be coming through. And I can remember them debating on whether or not we wanted to get out and go down the road to the church, or if we wanted to just stay at home and weather out the storm that was coming. And finally, after much debate and discussion, they decided that we would go to church. So we loaded up in the car and went down to the church. And we'd probably been there maybe 20 minutes, something like that. And we started to hear some strange noises, the wind whistling and howling through the windows, and the ground started to shake. Everyone wants to talk about the freight train sound, and it was a rumbling, deep rumbling and shaking sound. Everything started to shake. Everyone in the church started to look around at each other. And at about the same time, everyone got up, and we headed toward the door, the entry door that went down into the back of the church where the Sunday school rooms were. And we made it just to the foot of those steps in the hallway where those Sunday school rooms were when it hit. And it was chaos. We were all gathered there, and I can remember being underneath my father and looking up and watching the roof and the ceiling of the Sunday school area just disappear. It was just like it lifted off and disappeared. The wind was blowing and howling, and I can remember my dad reaching up to one of the Sunday school room doors and trying to open it. But I guess the pressure was such that the door wouldn't open. Well, finally, when it all settled down, he opened that door, and the Sunday school room that he was trying to open for us to go into was gone. It was outside. So all that was left was this hallway that we were in on the back of the church. Now, the odd thing about that was the church sanctuary building itself was completely intact. It might have had some missing shingles or something like that, but just a few feet away, it was completely intact. Now, the strange thing is, had we stayed at home, we would have probably been lost. Our entire house was gone. It wiped the house off the foundation. All of it was, there was debris everywhere. It was completely gone. Some of the bathroom walls were standing. They always say, go to the bathroom, and that's a good idea because that was all that was left standing of the house. And had we been there, I think we would have likely died. But it was strange because even though the house was just a little ways away, it was complete black. I mean, the cloud cover was over. There was no moonlight shining through, no power, no electricity anywhere. Everyone was a bit disoriented. There was debris falling from the sky. It was just a really, it was an unexplainable almost feeling, sensation that you have during those types of events. But thank you to many family and loved ones who pitched in and gave us a place to stay in the days right after, as the insurance and everything was being sorted out. That was just a blessing to have family and friends that could do that. Sure. Very little warning. Of course, there's been many advances in weather forecasting and those types of things in the years since. But at that time, we received the evening newscast, and the weather radar that was available at that time told about bad weather that was coming, but no other warnings, no tornado sirens or anything of that nature back then. We were very fortunate. No one that was at church that night, I don't even think there was a scratch on anyone. No one was hurt. In the days after, we received one of those trailers. It was set up on my parents' property, And that's where we lived while the house was being rebuilt. And the house has since, of course, been rebuilt in the spot where the other house was. Well, an event like this definitely, it puts an imprint on your mind for the rest of your life. So as we have bad weather, I'm always conscious of the weather. It doesn't cause me to be excessively fearful or those types of things, but I am very mindful and try to be take precaution when those types of events are coming. So this is our storm shelter, and I'll open it so you can take a look. This was one of the first things that we had installed. It's an all steel encased shelter that we've covered in concrete, and I have telephone and television and electricity in it, and so this is where we go if the weather gets bad. And it's so this is our storm shelter that we've installed for our family to gather in when the weather's bad. And we've installed some comforts, if you will. Of course, if the power's out, it wouldn't do you much good, but we have installed electricity and lights and telephone and television, TV cable. So this is where we go.
The April 3rd, 1974 super tornado outbreak tragically affected hundreds of Lincoln County residents. The power and danger of tornadoes have struck stark terror in the hearts of Lincoln Countyans, and those who were lost and injured by the force of nature will not be forgotten. We are learning more about tornadoes with improved technology and will continue to work to lessen the loss of life and property by increased warning lead times and severe weather preparedness. It is also hoped that this documentary will educate residents more about the dangers of severe weather and what we should do to be better prepared for the future. In the Tennessee Valley, it's not if this type of disaster will strike again, it's when.
Tim Troutman with the National Weather Service. We'd like to take this opportunity to thank the Elk Valley Times for giving us all the pictures, or many of the pictures, all the residents who's been a big help. We appreciate all the things you've done. One thing that we found out in this documentary is whether your business has come a long way in the last 40 years. And we appreciate all you do. We appreciate the Elk Valley Times, Fayetteville Public Utilities, all coming together to make this documentary happen. And once again, thanks for everything. And also, we want to thank all the people that we talked to today.
Thanks, yes, I agree. It's been a great partnership. And the objective, again, of the documentary has been to better educate and prepare us for severe weather when it does strike, and it does.
From the southeastern corner of Lincoln County in Van Town is where we started this morning, all the way from the state line, all the way through Shady Grove area. We want to thank you for watching this documentary here on Fayetteville Public Utilities Channel 6. Again, Tim Troutman, Don Counts, again, we thank you very much for watching.